Good evening, ladies as well as gentlemen. Papa Boris here, playing some more chess. This is a game that was recommended to me by a friend and subscriber of mine. Played in 1913 between Frank James Marshall on the white end and Ulrich Duras on the black end. Now, I'm not going to say who won the game, but I will say that both of these gentlemen elected to play an extremely exciting opening, which is what prompted my friend and subscriber to recommend this game to me. This is an illustration of the Danish Gambit. Now, briefly, Frank James Marshall was a very strong U.S. player. He was the United States champion for many years, and correspondingly Duras was a Czechoslovakian player, and he won the Czechoslovakian championship several years. So both players were very strong, some among the strongest of their home countries, and I won't say any more because I don't want to spoil the outcome. So here's the Danish Gambit. E4, and after black responds with the usual E5, we have D4. This is called the center game. It's not the Danish Gambit yet, and already the engine does not like this move, so the computer does not think that white gains much from this opening. This is a very romantic opening. It's fun, but not necessarily the soundest way to get an advantage out of the opening with white. After black takes, usual here, or at least recommended by the engine, is to play knight to f3 and kind of take your time winning back this pawn, centralizing your knight. But Frank Marshall didn't want none of that shit. He played c3. And now after d takes c3, you might think that, okay, well now white recaptures the pawn. White has given away a pawn in exchange for some open lines and a lead in development. And indeed, knight takes c3 is exactly what you do here. If you're a bitch! Real men and real women with balls of steel and labia of adamantium, respectively, play Marshall's next move, bishop to c4, giving away another pawn after c takes b2, which, by the way, is not the only option, but this is totally fine for black. White recaptures with bishop takes b2, and here's what we got. So white has given up three pawns, black has given up only a single pawn, so white is two pawns down. It's a double gambit. This is the Danish gambit accepted, ladies and gentlemen. However, white does have some compensation. The bishops are looking beautiful along these two adjacent diagonals, and so far, black has only moved a single piece all game, and that piece was a pawn, so he's definitely behind in development. So as white, you want to capitalize on your opening advantage and on all these beautiful open lines in the position and your two gorgeous bishops. As black, you just want to develop and, you know, get away with it, basically, and then you've got two extra pawns. Now, what's interesting is that this is probably not a sound gambit for white. The engine does say that black is ahead. But interestingly, the engine does not say that black is two pawns ahead. The engine just gives black here a half a pawn advantage. So the engine thinks that this is not really worth playing for white. It is a better thing for black, but the engine kind of does acknowledge that white does have some compensation and black's got some work to do to get out of this opening. So here's how it proceeded. Black played knight to f6, and here after e5, it's not the most precise continuation, but black needs to know what he's doing, because if black doesn't respond to this correctly, it's going to be a disaster for him. The engine recommends proceeding with knight to c3 and just getting on with development. So let's see what happens after e5. Black is put to a tough question. What do you do with this knight? You can't go to g4 or h5 because the white queen has those squares covered. Obviously, you can't go to d5, and you don't want to go back to your home space. So the only other move left is knight to e4. However, this is actually not that great, because now after white captures on f7 with check, and the king captures, white can go queen to f3 check and win back the piece. After the king humbly retreats, white takes the knight, and now this is totally fine for white. It's not like winning or anything, it's still a fairly equal position, but whatever advantage black may have had is now been mostly squandered. Because black has, again, nothing developed. All these moves with the knight were effectively wasted. White has developed an extra piece. The black king has moved, so he can no longer castle. That's a rule in chess. Once you've moved your king, you can't castle anymore, so it's going to be difficult for black to get to safety, and black missed out on an opportunity to get ahead out of the opening. So you don't want to play knight to e4. The opponent, Duras, here does find what is the correct continuation, which is d5. And so now, after e takes f6, what black needs to do here is play bishop to b4 check. So at the moment, white is up a piece, but his bishop's hanging. So the idea here is that after this check, however white responds to it, black will then be able to get his piece back. And there are some things that can get kind of hairy here for white. So if as white you try a calm, normal developing move like knight to c3, then black gets a pretty big advantage after queen to f6. This may look scary because the queen is opposite a bishop, but this knight is still pinned to the king and white can't castle yet. So white is still at least two moves away from unpinning that knight and being able to do something. At this moment as well, white is up a piece, black has three pieces to white's four, but two of white's pieces are hanging. The bishop and knight are both hanging, so white will get the piece back. There's no getting away with it for white, like you can't play bishop to b5 because then c6 is still attacking the bishop. And at that point, white's really got nothing better to do other than just to develop and let black have the piece back. And this is better for black. Notice that this position looks a lot better for black than the heady days in the early moves of the Danish Gambit, where white had these beautiful raking bishops across the diagonals. You know, if you're playing as white, then like something like this is not really what you were hoping to get out of the opening, with black still up seven pawns to your, well, actually to four. Black is pretty much one a pawn, although white will eventually be able to get back this d5 pawn. So black is still up a couple of pawns. You have to work to bring the total down from 3 to 2. Black's a move away from castling, and you really haven't done jack squat or snickerdoodle. So you have to be very careful, is what I'm saying, when black plays bishop to b4 check. One option is to try bishop to c3, and then after bishop takes, knight takes, you know, you can just recapture the bishop. And there's nothing super crazy here for white or for black. If white tries to take on g7, black can just move the rook. And, you know, it's not super hot, but it's also not the end of the world either. White has lost both of his bishops, and so the fact that, you know, black's not castling anytime soon is not as big of a deal. So that would be the correct response for black, is to play bishop to b4 check. However, here is where Duras made his first mistake. He played d takes c4 immediately. And the problem with taking on c4 immediately is that it allows white to exchange queens and then play f takes g7. Perhaps Duras was thinking that, well, you know, if white doesn't want to exchange queens. He played the Danish Gambit, he wants to attack. Who's going to trade queens when they're down pawns? But the thing that Duras perhaps had overestimated is that white has a lot of activity even when the queens are off the board because of this pawn that's just one square away from queening and is currently attacking two pieces. So now Duras, a move too late, plays bishop to b4 check. But the thing is that after knight to c3, there is no more queen to take the pawn in f6, and so this is like a perfectly fine developing move. White's just gonna castle queenside next move, unpin the knight, and be off to the races. Black also has to deal with this rook that's currently attacked. So here Duras played rook to e8 check, and this is a mistake, because while it is true that that is a check and it comes with tempo, the rook doesn't necessarily want to be on e8. The rook wants to be on g8 so that it can take this damn pawn. But now after rook to e8 check, white simply plays knight to e2, developing the knight and blocking the check at the same time, and now black just looks stupid. This white pawn is still one move away from queening, which means that this rook of black's has to babysit the back row, and because the rook went here instead of to g8, the pawn can't even be captured right now. If black went to g8 now, this would be extremely stupid, because black has essentially wasted a move, giving white an extra move and developing the knight, which is what white wanted to do anyways. Black follows up this bad situation with another mistake. He plays bishop to f5. The correct play here, if you're going to move that bishop, is to move it to e6. And if you're wondering what's the difference between e6 and f5, we shall see. Now, Marshall played castle queenside with check. So getting out of this pin on the knight, putting his king to somewhat resembling safety. You know, when the queens are off the board, the lack of pawns here is not that big of a deal. And also putting his rook from the corner onto a nice open file, and with tempo, no less. So here, black played knight to d7, and that looks okay, because it's, you know, developing the knight and blocking the check, but white has knight to d5 here. This harasses the black bishop and puts white's knight on a nice centralizing square. This is why black should have moved this light bishop to e6. If it was on e6, it could capture this knight right now. But as it stands, the bishop has to move. And by the way, note that white's knight on e2 is not actually able to be captured. This would be a disaster because white gets a queen on g8. So this rook, until this king can somehow move forward a step, is still stuck babysitting the back row. Okay, so bishop goes to d6. And now white centralize, or what white plays bishop to f6 check. Now, this is considered a mistake by the engine. The engine says that the better move to play here was either knight to d4, harassing this light squared bishop, or rook to e1, just developing the rook on the open file. But I don't think I can really blame Marshall for playing bishop to f6 because knight d4 or rook to e1, these are good moves. They're developing moves. They're just, you know, continuing to have a good positional advantage in the position. Whereas bishop to f6 has a tangible benefit. Black doesn't really want to play king to c8 here because this bishop is just really strong in this square and the king's blocking these rooks from ever getting connected. And white can just continue now to build pressure in the position. In fact, the engine does recommend doing what Duras did, which is trying to relieve some of the pressure by sacrificing the exchange. Duras takes on f6, and after the white knight takes on f6, notice the knight is forking the rook on e8 and the queening square g8. And this rook has nowhere to go. If it moves up, again, white will queen, and all three of these squares are covered by white's pieces, so the rook's got nowhere to go. So here Duras played king to e7. This is the point of the exchange sacrifices. It frees this other rook. Now Marshall takes the rook, black recaptures, and white has a small advantage in this position. Despite being up the exchange, white has a rook for a bishop. White is still down pawns. He has only five pawns to the six of black's. Black does have a passed pawn here on c4, and black also notably has the bishop pair, which is very good in an open position because bishops thrive when positions are open. Meanwhile, white has a knight, which is less effective. So white is slightly better, but black has a lot of compensation, and at this point, even though black's down the exchange, the game could go in either way. However, it is worth noting that probably, you know, the psychological advantage is very heavily in favor of white, just given how black's been kicked around for the last several moves. So now black needs to try to win this pawn, and Marshall knows this. So what do you do as white when you know that black's going to try to win the pawn? He tries rook to d4. And so the idea here is that if black were to directly go bishop to e5, white would actually capture c4, which is one of black's most valuable assets. It's a passed pawn, and after bishop takes g7, white could capture the pawn on c7. So black's actually losing a pawn in this variation. He's going down two pawns just to get one. Oh boy, excuse me. And white is definitely better here. So Duras elects not to go for the pawn with the bishop. He goes with the queen. He plays king to f6. But Marshall here makes a series of extremely clever moves, taking advantage of the fact that he knows how desperate black is to get rid of this thorny pawn. First, Marshall plays a very precise move, knight to g3, defending this pawn with a tactic. If the king takes the pawn, of course, the bishop is down, and white is just completely winning this game. Now he's up a piece. He's really up a whole rook. So black can't take the pawn. So, okay, he goes bishop to a3 check, and after the after the king moves, Duras plays bishop to g6, moving the light squared bishop out of harm's way. Now Marshall finds another very clever move. He plays f4, again protecting the pawn with a tactic. If the king takes the pawn on g7, then f5 wins this piece. So again, the pawn can't be taken. All right, fine. So Duras plays bishop to d3, getting the bishop out of the way, but now comes knight to h5 check. Again, protecting the pawn, though this time directly. Notice that Marshall isn't just going crazy trying to save the pawn. He's not making passive moves. This knight went from here to here to here, so he's getting more active in the position. He's kind of boxing the black king into a corner. Marshall also made this nice centralizing rook move. So he's making moves that develop his own position while also delaying black's ability to recapture this pawn. After king to g6, white plays rook to e1. This is an interesting threat because if black exchanges rooks, then after white takes the rook back, there's actually no way to stop this pawn from queening. So it actually is threatening the black rook. The black rook has to move, goes to g8, blocking that pawn. And now we have rook to d5. So the idea here is Marshall knows that the pawn on g7 will get lost, but it's going to take black two moves to take it. He's going to have to go bishop to b2, and then he's going to have to take it on g7. So when you're Marshall in this position, you got to ask yourself, what are the most valuable things I could do in two moves? And rook to d5 is a very interesting move because it puts a lot of pressure on the black king. It's like a psychologically aggressive move. You know, it's scary as black to think of the rook coming to g5 with check. And so here, Marshall actually provokes a mistake from Duras in playing h6. You don't really want to make this move because it doesn't actually do anything. Psychologically, it feels safe to have your king on h7 behind a pawn, but actually, black's king would have been totally fine on h6. It's really difficult for white to get at it. So, using h6 as a tuck away square for the king would have been just fine. Black here, you know, could have just kept on going. If he really didn't want the rook come to g5, he could have played like f5, for example, and blocked it that way. There's nothing super scary with rook to e6. In fact, sorry, the other advantage of f5 is that it actually makes this knight capturable. So now white would have to do something about this knight, you know, and black would have been not fine. He's still losing here, but he would have been better off than with h6. After h6, white simply develops the other rook, and now black goes on to try to capture that pawn on g7. Here, Marshall played g4, strengthening that knight, and finally the g7 pawn goes down. But now, Marshall's got shit to do. He plays f5 check. He pushes that king into the corner. Note that you don't really want to go to g5 because then after f6, you're checked and your bishop is attacked by the pawn and the knight protects the pawn so the king can't take the pawn so you lose a piece. So the king has to go to h7. And now simply rook to e7. Rooks love seventh ranks and all of black's pawns are under attack here. So black's not love on this position. He decided to play rook to f8, at least protecting the pawn from f on f7 from being lost, which makes sense. If you do let that pawn go, if you make some random move and let white take the pawn, now your bishop is pinned and white's about to win it with f6. And if you try to run away with king to h8, then white simply doubles rooks on the seventh rank, and now you got some major issues. The bishop can never move because then rook to h7 is checkmate, so that bishop is going to be lost, and that's very, very bad for your interests. So Duras stops this. He's always on the defensive here with rook to f8, and now Marshall plays rook takes c7. This was not the most precise continuation. Better would have been to just double rooks on the seventh rank anyways. After rook takes c7, black did have a way to wriggle out a little bit. He could have played, in this position, bishop to e4, attacking white's rook. And the rook can't go to either of the squares that would attack that bishop because the bishop on g7 is covering them both. So after the rook moves, say, to d2, c3. And now the pawn is protected by this bishop, and it's starting to get a little bit close to being queened. And so now white can double rooks, but it's not as bad because black has advanced this passed pawn. So black has a little bit of counterplay. You can also like go here, for example, and win this pawn on g4 and attack the knight. You know, things get a little bit hairy. So black could have done a little bit better defending. Endgames are very difficult. It's very deceptive because when there's fewer pieces, you think the game would be easier to play, but because there's so few pieces and the board is wide open, there's lots of possible moves, and it's very difficult to find the right one. So here, Duras slipped up big time. He played bishop to c3. And the problem is that this just immediately ends the game. He completely missed White's next move, which Marshall, to his credit, found, which is rook takes d3. And now, if you take the rook, then you lose the bishop on c3, and at this point, white is up a whole piece. So previously, like back here, white is up the exchange, meaning that white has a rook for a minor piece. Being up a whole piece is actually more valuable than being up the exchange. And on top of that, if we look at this again, white is going to win this d3 pawn. So black lost his passed pawn, which was his only advantage. He has absolutely no advantages in the position. There's no counterplay whatsoever. So white's just up a piece. This is totally winning, and it's very easy to win as well. Duras played bishop to e5, but this is actually like worse because after the rook moves, white is now up a whole rook. So instead of being up a whole piece, white is up a whole rook. And at this point, Duras realized it was over, and so he resigned. Thank you very much for watching this video. I hope that you enjoyed it. And if you're a crazy person who loves wild games of chess, consider giving the Danish Gambit a shot. Just make sure that you know what the hell you're doing, because one wrong move on either side can definitely end the game in a spectacular fashion pretty quickly. I'll see you soon.